In the middle of the night, Lord, I'm praying for assurance, everything's gonna be alright. Lord, I see another battle, and it's out in front of me. I'm afraid I won't be able, and I'll go down in defeat. And he said, do you remember just where I brought you from? Won't you take a look behind you and see how far you've come? Every time you ask me, didn't I deliver you? So why would you be thinking that I wouldn't see you through? Didn't I walk on the water and I called the raging sea? I spoke to the wind and it hushed and I gave you peace. Didn't I run to your rescue? Didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I do it all again. Now he's talking to her father in a house that was once a home. She said, my bills are coming due, Lord. 6 days is not that long. She hears a voice so soft and low. It says, I've moved like that before. I will do this little thing, child, and I'll give you so much more. Didn't I walk on the water and I calmed the raging sea? I spoke to the wind and it hushed and I gave you peace. Didn't I run to your rescue? Didn't I hear you when you called? I walked right beside you just so you wouldn't fall. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I do it all again. Didn't I leave all of heaven just to die for your sin? I searched until I found you, and I do it all again.
You're a wonderful looking congregation this morning. We've got some folks that are sick, and some are on vacation, and some are contemplating on going on vacation. But we're glad to see you here this morning. Would you turn to your neighbor and say, hey, you look good in church today. And for all of you husbands, look back again to your wives and say, hey, you look good all the time. I'm sorry I didn't get you in trouble. We're going to do one we hadn't done in a while. Beneath the cold clay,
cold at first I stay. I'll shout it so loud, the heavens will ring. Now death is the master over all the land. No one can escape from his ready hand.
In Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, yea, how God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden. And the woman said unto the serpent, you may eat of the fruit of the tree of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat of it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Brother Alfred, would you pray for the message? I want to preach to you this morning on, did God say? Question mark. Did God say? From time to time, we are old enough to communicate in our lives, we've got questions. I think every little child goes through the but why. Why do I have to do that? Tell me why. I got some grandchildren that's older than little children, and they still ask why. Questions are a very important way of learning. And a good teacher will even ask questions to get the students thinking and talking about the solutions to problems that are in our lives. Questions can also be used, by the way, to deceive. One of the very first questions of the Bible was the kind of question that the serpent was asking Eve in our text. In this passage, we find a trick question that Satan is asking and using very effectively today to deceive and lure people toward destroying sin. Did God really say? Satan is the master of the deceiver. Notice the sky is smooth, non-aggressive way that he moves into someone and he isolates them and tries to cast down upon God's people when God said you don't do it and you go ahead and do it anyway. He simply asked Eve a question. A lot of times I've heard people get up and badger the women because Eve done it. But it's not only the women, men, it's you too. Amen. Eve knew the answer, but her knowledge, quite possible, was a second-handed knowledge since the Bible said she was created after God. God made the commandment to Adam to avoid the tree of knowledge. Satan started with a question, then he asked, did you hear the original answer? She had heard about the tree, so she told the devil what she thought was the word of God. Satan wants you to answer what we think about the word of God, but he don't want you to tell him the truth. He knows that he said is just looking for knowledge, or our faith is in knowledge today. His whole purpose is to kill and to destroy. That's his purpose. Satan desires to cast doubt about the godliness of, or the goodness of God and the good intentions that God has for us. You see, if Satan can get us to ask questions about God's word, he begins to put doubt what God has already said. If he can get you to start going around asking this denomination and that denomination and this denomination, he can put doubt in your mind. But it's not what the denomination says, it's what saith the word of God. That's what it's all about. Satan desires to cast doubt on it. You see, if Satan can get you to question God's word, he begins to cause you to doubt about what God has really said. Or to ask ourselves, did God really mean what he said? Then has he opened the door wide open to play mind game with you? When he said, thou shalt not steal, does that mean that if it's laying in a person's yard that I just can't pick it up? It's just laying out there. We were going down the road one day this week, and a big old umbrella had moved somewhere off of somebody's yard, and the wind had picked it up, and it had took it to a place down the road where there was nobody there. And I told Sister Lawless, I said, you know, somebody will get that. She said, but it belongs to those houses probably up the road. But you see, they're going to say, well, there wasn't no houses around. And the first thing you know, they're going to pick it up. They knew it wasn't theirs, but the devil put doubt in their mind that they can get it. We see, we find ourselves one of the first questions of the Bible is the kind of question that the serpent was asked to Eve in the text. In this passage, we find that the devil is trying to trick Eve and deceive her and to do things that she ought not do. But we find that she had heard about the tree, so she told the devil, I think I know what it means. But you see, if Satan can get you to question him, what God is saying, or ask ourselves, did God really mean it that way? We often entertain the wrong idea and finally put God's word back into the text. Then when God doesn't instantly bring judgment, Satan convinces you that it's okay to continue. You may rob a bank and you may not get caught for a week or two. But when you do get caught, you're going to realize it was wrong. But the first two or three weeks, you might decide, well, I don't guess it was bad as it thought it was. But I'm here to tell you, your sins will find you out. You don't get away from God. You don't get away from God whatsoever. And when you sin, you're going to be judged by that sin. If you reap to the whirlwind, you're going to reap the whirlwind. Yes. Then that road leads to destruction. When tempted, no one should say, God has tempted me. I hate to hear somebody say that. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone. The devil tempts, not God. He gives you power to be more than a conqueror through the Lord Jesus Christ. It's through him and by faith that he helps you get through those times when the devil is tempting you and trying to destroy you. But each one is tempted when, by his own evil desires, he's drugged away and enticed. That's what the enemy does. Then after desires has conceived, it gives birth to sin. And sin is a full-grown, gives birth to death. Because that's what the Bible says. Satan is a master. If you know to do it good and doeth it not to you is sin, it will carry you to hell. But preacher, I'm a young person. It doesn't matter. Young people go to hell every day. Young people go to hell. Middle-aged people go to hell. Old people go to hell. And after he has a huge percentage of the world not believing that God doesn't even exist. This is why we need God's word in our life. We need to preach it, teach it, devour it, and do as David said that we ought to do. Psalms 119 and 11, he said, I have hidden your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. You see, that's a bad thing that's going on today. Sin is destroying this world. I don't want to get into politics, but this president election race is getting sicker and sicker and sicker. I'm so tired of that. There's only one thing I wish the Lord would do. I wish he would come on down and get
that we don't even know what's going to happen tomorrow, but we know who holds tomorrow, and his name is Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God.
Yes. Notice David didn't say he had it in his head. I get laughing at Sister Lawless sometimes. She said that I always told her she didn't have a brain. But I was kidding. And when she went to the doctor, Sister Tina, the doctor told her she had a brain. And when she came home, she said, "I want you to know something." And I said, "What's that?" She said, "I have got a brain." I said, "Well, thank the Lord." That question was answered. Did God really say what part of God's word does Satan has to question about? I'll tell you what it is. He questions from Genesis to Revelation. And if he can get you to doubt his word, you lose out with God. Did God really say that Jesus was born of a virgin? Some denominations don't even preach that anymore. Did Jesus really say, "Come back to life and he would resurrect your body"? Did Jesus really say that the wages of sin is death, both physical and spiritual? Did Jesus really say that Jesus is the only way to find eternal life? Did God really say that if a man's in his sin, that he will be eternally separated from God in a place that's called hell? Did God really say that a man is to bring his first fruits, his tithes? Oh, preacher, you just messed that whole message up. I know we can't afford to pay tithes. What'd you say? We can't afford not to. How good God's been to you. I want the little bit that you have, he can bless it, multiply it, give you what you need. He loves you, and he cares about you. When you can answer these questions, excuse me, in full faith, Satan is powerless. When you can leave this room for him to work his deception, and he will. When you can't rely on secondhand knowledge, truly know firsthand what God really said, he meant it. He loves you and he cares for you. That comes from a relationship and knowledge. Then you're on the road from Satan's trickery and to God's truth. This brings us to the second question. Then the man and his wife heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden. The Bible said in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord called to the man. He said, "Where are you? Where are you? Where are you?" In verse 8 and 9. Where are you? The question God asked Adam was not because God needed the information. He knew where it was at. Right. Anytime you see God ask the question in the scripture, it's always a question to get you to tell the truth. For not him, because he's not a liar. He knows the answer. He wants you to admit the truth about yourself. Has your wife ever looked at you and said, you are so and so? And you knew you wasn't? Some of these women were doing that too. And you know you wasn't. Anybody ever accused you of something that you know you didn't do? Nowhere have we ever convinced ourselves and others to ease our conscience. Sin is sin. You may not want to call it what it is. It may be because your son or daughter might be doing it. And you may say, well, I used to feel this way, and that's what the Bible said, but now I don't do that. Wrong is wrong. You can pat it on the back. You can let it follow you. You can carry it to bed with you. But when it's time to get up in the morning, you're going to still be in sin. God asked Adam, where are you? God knew where he was. He said, I'm naked. I'm afraid. I'm hiding in the weeds. He'd been naked the whole time, but it never bothered him before. Sin exposed him. And sin will expose you. You'll get by for a while. You'll think nobody cares and nobody knows. But sooner or later, judgment will knock on your door. And when it does, you're going to think back and you're going to say, hey, if I'd only listened to what it was about. He used to walk with God in the garden. Now he's hiding in shame. And it's all started with entertaining the question, did God really mean what he said? We want to criticize their decisions they made, one rule to follow. Yet, if we're honest, we'll fall for the same trick that Adam and Eve fell for if we don't stay in tune with God. Letting that question grow in your heart until we give in. Hiding our sins and doing what we know is wrong. A very sick lawyer was dying, and a preacher came to visit. To his surprise, he found him reading the Bible. After asking what he was doing, the preacher got the following response. If you don't get anything else I said, you can get this. He said, what are you doing? He said, I'm reading my Bible. He said, well, what else did you want to tell me? He said, I'm cramming for my final. Because he knew nothing's going to count when you lay on your deathbed. You may think, well, I'm young and I'm invincible. And I got my whole life ahead of me. Don't be fooled like that. You could leave this world tomorrow. When that angel comes to get you, it's not how old you are. It's not how much money you have or how happy you are. You could be married tomorrow and die the next day. Don't mean a thing. The thing that matters in this world, have you made your calling assured? And is your name written in the Lamb Book of Life? And it hasn't, then you need to do something about it, that you know that if I die today, did God really say that I could die today? He said, life is short. You and I can live to be 100 years old, but not a whole lot of people do that. We've come to a time in this life that we don't know what to do and when it's going to end. Make preparations to meet God, because he really did say that. by them. They're right close. Oh, God, help us. Help us, Lord. If this was your last day, on the face of this earth, if this was the last time that you'd ever get to bring your family to the house of God. Oh, but preacher, I'm doing so good. I got a new car. I got a good place to live. I got a family. God just smiling on me. What are you doing for Him? What are you doing for Him? Sooner or later, you got to make a decision. Got to make a decision. My younger ministry, I pastored a church by the name of George's Creek Church of God over at Easley. And I've done a few funerals, but not a whole lot. I think I told you this years ago, but I feel it too. Was a 26-year-old man with a family. For some unforeseen reason, he just died. His mother and daddy were by the name of Shook, brother and sister Shook. Brother Shook come, a small, frail man, come and said, "Brother Wallace, would you preach our son's funeral?" Brother Milton, it was 3 hours away on a Sunday afternoon. I didn't make it back to the church that night, but we loaded up and headed to the mountains. Drove up a road that had snow on it. And as we drove down that road, it went for miles, got to a little bitty church. The road kept right on going by the church. And piano was out of tune. Didn't even have a bathroom in the church. It was way back down a path in the back. I was the only minister who would preach for him. As I got through, Brother Taylor, we walked on the outside and buried him below the church. It was cold. Eyes were spewed in the grave. It was so cold. And for the first time in my ministry, I looked at that grave. Up there, we all just went out and they buried him right before our eyes. It was cold. It was dark. What a dark place to go to. And as I let that casket down in that hole that day,
was something that went all over me that never happened to me before. I realized, Brother Jack, that's final if you don't know the Lord. When they let him down and they started to throw the dirt in on top of him, I stood and cried and I said, Lord, don't let anyone die lost. Give everybody an opportunity. And I was standing there and the Lord spoke to me. He said, whosoever will. And I said, thank you, Lord. Thank you. Don't let this opportunity pass you by. Don't allow the enemy to steal your soul. If you knew this was the last time that you would ever see this church, this preacher, your music, what would you do? There's a lot of things you can take chances with. You can go out and buy an old used car. You may make it home and you may not. But you don't take a chance with your soul. He said if a man were to gain the whole world and lose his soul, what is he profit? What has he got? What has he made? I can tell you, he hasn't made anything. Life is not real. It's not fair. People die every day. But it's up to me as a shepherd to warn you. Breaking his house, he wouldn't have left. You get in that old car, you don't know if you can make it home or if you're not. You don't know that an old drunk will run into you and kill you. Oh God, somebody reach your hand toward heaven. Plead the blood for somebody here this morning. You stood before God today and your soul was required. What would he say? Would he say, welcome home? Imagine it's raining. Or would he say, depart from me, for I never knew you. Never made things right. You can be a good moral person and die and go to hell. You must be born again. Oh, do you feel his power here this morning? I feel it. He's here. Hallelujah. I want you to stand all over this building. If you haven't made preparations to meet the Lord, won't you make them this morning? If there's anything in your life that's not like God, why don't you pray? Why don't you pray? You see, I preached senior citizens. I preached teenagers. I preached middle-aged. I preached babies, funerals. Jesus is calling. Hallelujah. Anybody want to pray? If you knew before you got home you were going to get killed and you don't know that, would you pray? Would you pray? You're trying to make a decision right now. Saying don't go. Preacher, don't know what he's talking about. You're almost persuaded. I want to go. I want to straighten my life up. I'm going to get ready to meet the Lord. I'm waiting on you.
Jesus.
It don't cost nothing. Oh, hallelujah. The price was paid over 2,000 years ago when Jesus died on the cross. I'm waiting on you. I know who you are. I can put my hand on you. But you must do it. Will you come? Will you meet me right here at the altar? You're not really happy the way you are. You're not doing right and you know it. Do you want your life changed? You want to live for God? Those tears that's coming down your face. God's speaking to you. Would you lift your hands, saints of God, and pray right now? God's calling you. Won't you come on home? Won't you grab that loved one beside you and say, hey, let's go. I'm ready to change the way we're living. I'm ready. Get ready to go to be with the Lord. Will you come? If you'll take that first step, you won't even know about the next ones. It'll be so easy. But you gotta do it. I want you to sing that one more time. I just can't close right now. Somebody's getting a call from God. And when you walk out that door, you're saying, no. No, God. I don't want you. I don't want you, Father. But you do. That's a trick of the devil. Saints of God, pray. Sing it one more time. He's calling you.
So
meet me right here.
Tenderly, Jesus.
When he comes,
he's calling.
I'm waiting on you.
Calling for you and for me.
I'm waiting on you. It's up to you. Come on up here, Tam, come on, honey.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Glory to you. Thank you, Lord, for your healing mercy. Hallelujah. 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 You step out. It's time for you to make a change.
Yes.
Do what God's calling you to do. Nobody knows how happy you can be by serving God. I know some people say, well, if I get saved, I got to pay my tithes. You wouldn't have been doing that to start with. If I go to church and live right, I can't do a lot of things that I don't, that I like to do. God will give you other things to do. I can't get saved because I lose my old friend. If they get away from you because you're a Christian, they wouldn't friends start with. God will give you new friends. I got a whole church full of friends. Amen. Praise God. Give the Lord a big hand clap, would you? I listened to you clap this morning, and I listened to some of the ball games yesterday, how they was a hollering and going on. They do a lot better than we do. Clap your hands for the Lord. Praise the Lord. He's a good God. He's a good God. They ain't got nothing to cheer for. Go up there and their team win or lose, don't make no difference. What is he giving you? What do you get off eating ball games? When you come to church and give your life to the Lord, He's giving you eternal life. Praise God. He loves you. Let me say to you young people, serve God. I'm as close as you follow. If you need me, all you got to do is follow. I am so glad to see people getting saved. I didn't get to preach this morning like I wanted to. And I must have preached the way the Lord wanted me to. God's good. Would you stand? Be back tonight, 6 o'clock. If you, the praise team is going in the choir, and we're not going to have anybody standing out, we're going to be in the choir. And we're going to turn the mics on and all up there. If you want to sing, and I know what some of you are saying right now, I can't sing. How many sings in the shop? You're not going to admit it, I knew you would. But you sing somewhere. If you're going down the road and a good song comes on, I mean, sing with the song.
Amen.
All y'all not in the choir, I'll tell you that right now. You need to be. Sing for the Lord. You'll get some benefit out of it.
Father, we just worship you and thank you for this service. We thank you for the lives that have been touched and changed today, Father. We thank you for the way that you move and work in our hearts, Father. We just ask today as we leave the house of God that you guide and direct our hearts and our spirits, Father. We just praise you in Jesus Christ's precious name.
Amen. Thank you.
Are you?